is an important part of the process. We'll definitely reach a consensus, and hopefully we can be in a position based upon concrete revenue forecasts to try to avoid further putting the state in the hole by us creating more taxes, or I guess they're called revenue enhancers nowadays, in this budget process than we already have right now. And hopefully a budget forecast will show we don't need those taxes.
Cutting through the bureaucracy, Senator John DeFrancisco joins your voice in a call to protect taxpayer money. I'm Julia Locandy. Last week you talked about getting beyond the noise. We were talking about school safety, and I really kind of want to continue on with that because it really makes a lot of sense. Not necessarily talking about school safety today, but the budget and what people should really know. And even with the tax changes, there's just so much from so many different sides that come out. It's hard to tell what's the actual truth.
Well, you know, politics it has politics in it, you know, and that's what happens. That's why it's difficult. Even if you're in the middle of everything, you got to cut through all of that stuff. And I can't imagine how the general public can. And perfect example, we just had one segment of the budget process called the revenue forecasts. Basically, you can't decide what the budget's going to be till you see what money is available. And you don't know necessarily exactly how many tax dollars are come in. You don't know exactly every dollar that's going to go out, but you try to give the best estimate. So every year when I was chairman of finance, I would go to the budget forecast meeting. Well, this year I went in lieu of Kathy Young, who's chairman of finance. She was in another meeting, and I went there, and we heard from three economists, or maybe there was four. Yeah, one was on the phone. So there were four. And basically, each economist had their opinion as to what the economy was going to look like. But and all of them came without the general opinion that the economy is going to be pretty good, and that the revenues that were forecast are going to be previously were going to be less than what actually is going to happen because of the tax cut and all of this other stuff, that the economy is going quite well. The final number will show that we'll have more money to cut taxes with or to spend than we anticipated. Now, you tell me which one you think is going to happen, spend or cut taxes, and that's part of my frustration with government. But in any event, to start it off, Robert Mojica, who's the budget director of the state of New York, he's the appointee of Governor Cuomo, starts making the speech and how the federal government has hurt us with the tax cut. He went on and on, targeted New York and all the high-tech states. It was a political speech. It had nothing to do with revenue forecasts. And ironically, it was the opposite, because of the recent policies, they're forecasting more revenue to come in. It was totally contradictory, but he had to follow, no doubt at the governor's direction, the mantra that all the problems of the state of New York are caused by the federal government, which obviously is not true. So I responded to that, as I usually do, because I can't stand hearing nonsense, and people can judge what he says and judge what I say to determine what the true state of affairs are in the state of New York.
So why have we pushed so hard in response to the federal tax changes within such a short period of time, and why is this relevant to today's proceedings? Is that we have gone to these lengths because we think the integrity of New York's tax base is at stake. A capped SALT deduction is tantamount to an increase in the state's income taxes for millions of New Yorkers. We are at risk of losing some of our residents to states that are less disadvantaged by the federal changes and lose less. Finally, the federal tax law threatens lower home values by as much as 10%. For some of our downstate counties. According to Moody's Analytics, for middle-class families in the Hudson Valley, in Long Island, in New York City, they will see their property values go down by up to 10%. This is most middle-class families' most valuable asset. The reduction in the value of their homes will make families less wealthy, and they will feel less wealthy. And as a result, they will spend less. They will, in turn, spend less in their local community businesses, and we receive that in the form of lower sales tax receipts for New York.
I didn't realize this was going to be a political statement about the federal government, So since there was, I'll give you a little response. The fact of the matter is that one of the reasons people are leaving the state of New York is the fact that we have high taxes in the state. And I can't imagine anyone saying that there's a deliberate intent on the federal government to hurt New York State, California, and the like. The legislation hurt those states that spend too much and tax too much. As far as an exodus from the state of New York because of the federal government, that seems to be the theme. The fact of the matter is there's been an exodus from the state of New York over the last several years. And we have an obligation as well to put our house in order. And some of the questions I'll be asking, if I'm still here, will be around the effect that high taxes have in the state of New York on home ownership, on people leaving the state of New York, and what recommendations there might be as far as how we can make our economy better, what we can do to make the our economy better, rather than pointing to the federal government and for the blame for some problem. We're willing to accept the additional revenues from the good economy and from the markets and the bonuses and all that, and that didn't come by chance, I don't think. It came by a change in policy and more confidence in the economy in the United States.
So that is the noise you are talking about.
You know, it boggles the mind, but that's what people have to go through, and it's very frustrating for those who are part of the process, more frustrating, no doubt, for the general public.
Right. So what is next?
Well, now that we have the amount of dollars that we know are likely to come in, you could then say, okay, how are these dollars going to be used? It could be tax cuts, it could be spending, and so forth. Now, if you remember, the governor's budget had, in his words, $1 billion of revenue enhancements. And as I've said several times, that means in the governor's glossary of terms, taxes and fees. Well, now with the additional revenue, there should be no need for additional taxes and fees. In view of the fact that more revenues are coming in. Well, that's one argument. The argument most likely by the Assembly and the governor, well, we've got more money that we can spend. We still should raise taxes and fees or revenue enhancers. So that's what happens from this point forward. The Senate will come up with its proposed budget and do a one-house budget bill, just like the governor provided his executive budget, and the Assembly will do the same. The way it's supposed to work, and it does most times, is that then joint conferences are scheduled for both the Assembly and the Senate to try to negotiate the differences in the three budgets, the governor's and the two House budgets. And then ultimately and magically, by April 1, we've got to have a budget that's balanced and uses those funds either, as I say, in tax cuts or spending more.
Right. And when we talk about the public trust and how our tax dollars are being spent. You have brought up the facility in DeWitt where the company just backed out of. What's going on with that?
Well, basically, this company was given $90 million, not given, the state built a $90 million factory for a company. State retained ownership, or an agency of the state retained ownership. Well, the company that was supposed to create hundreds of jobs just left. They never came in. And there was no penalties for them just leaving, which kind of irritated me. If you were putting a huge amount of your own money in, wouldn't you have some kind of security that if they break the deal? Well, that's not the way the state of New York works under the Cuomo administration. So now you got an empty factory. No penalties against the person that left, the company that left. So now they come up with a concept that they want to put someone else in there, a company called NextGen, which is a company owned by the same person who started a company in Rochester and made all kinds of promises 2 years earlier of creating hundreds of jobs. That company went bankrupt. Fortunately, no money was spent in that deal. So now they change names, they come in here, they want to use the factory. Plus, they want $15 million more. And the jobs, instead of 400 or 500 jobs, now are 200 or 300 jobs maximum. So I wanted to know it's in my district. I wanted to know what the penalties were if they just get up and walk. And I got all kinds of verbiage, and I got all kinds of generalities, and I didn't get that information. So the final step in the process was the Public Authorities Control Board, which is one representative of the Senate, one of the Assembly, and one of the governor, reviews it and decides whether they're going to give the $15 million more. So I objected, and the Senate stopped the vote for one session. And I said, until there's in writing what the penalties are and whether I agree with the penalties or not, at least the public knows generally what we're doing and what protection they have, if any, rather than broad generalities, which was always the case in the past. So they did that. They put it in writing. To me, they're weak penalties, but at least they're known. And so the Public Authority Control Board could make a decision based upon fact rather than simply verbal assurances. Mm-hmm. And so it ended up passing. Now this building at least will be occupied if the new company honors its obligations, but at least there's some penalties in case they don't.
Right. And there was a project in Buffalo. It really basically amounted to a basic call center jobs. It was supposed to be this boon, and it's considered a chaotic workplace, and it's kind of like the same theme as we're talking about.
It's the same concept, and the concept is you get promised hundreds of high technology jobs, and there's a great news conference for the governor, and he just preens before the cameras, and everybody talks about how this is a turning point in the Western New York. Same deal as in Syracuse. The company did not perform, did not even start their process. So they put another company in. And what is it? Telemarketing jobs. Telemarketing jobs. I think the plant was like $50 million or something. It's a joke. So the thing I want to bring us back to is that there's a lot of economic development money proposed by the governor in this budget. And what I'm going to insist on is that there be disclosure of what the real deal is before any money is spent. And the Senate is involved with the process, just like we're involved with the Public Authority Control Board. And so that we can make certain there's penalties and security if a company goes bad. I'm not asking for anything radical. I'm just asking for what I would want if I'm loaning somebody money or providing funding for a project.
It is apparent that people have lost faith in government, and they've lost faith in their public officials. And that actually reminds me of a story that just came out recently where the governor's very first executive order was to prohibit employees and appointees from contributing to his campaign, yet he did it anyway.
You know, you really can't make this stuff up.
Seriously.
It seems like every day we come in here, whenever we have a talk, something else pops up. And my analysis of it is simply that the governor does anything he wants, whenever he wants to do it, whether right or wrong, whether legal or illegal. Now, you got to understand, an executive order came from the governor saying it's illegal to accept donations from appointees to boards and authorities. Illegal. He signs it. It's not that he's stuck with this from somebody else. He signs it. It's not that the legislature imposed it upon it. He signs it.
Right.
So all of a sudden, there's an article, a great article in the New York Times, investigative reporting, that basically show he accepted over $2 million from appointees. But what's even better is, because you really can't make it up. What's better is his counsel comes out and says, well, really, the reason he could do it, it's really not outlawed by that executive order. The reason he could do it is because it didn't apply to appointees that are in a specific term of office, like a 4-year term or a 2-year term or whatever. Every single person, every lawyer that commented on that analysis by the governor's lawyer said it's sophistry. It's not what the order says. So he got such bad pushback from that. Then the next explanation was, well, it really didn't apply to the governor because these people were not those who have to sign this form that shows you're a policymaker in the state of New York. And since they didn't have to file this form, they still could donate. Again, it's not what the order says. But it's a 2-day story. The governor goes on his merry way, buys a dog, and takes pictures with the dog. And it's all over.
People don't forget these things, though.
Well, I hope not. I hope not, because he's got to go. He's got to go.
Absolutely. Well, we talk about how your voice matters, and right now, tipped workers are putting the heat on one of the governor's plans to take away their tips. He wants one fair wage, and they say that this is important to them.
Well, yeah, the governor has basically a theory of government that says, what I want to do is make sure from a political standpoint I'm in the best position I can. And obviously there's a whole, when we went to the $15 million hourly rate wage, he imposed it unilaterally through his labor department and only to fast food restaurants. Now think of that. Now why? Because there was a national movement for the $15 minimum wage by some labor groups. So it's obviously the best thing to do. So what he's trying to do is to also continue that process and say that the minimum wage, which right now it's a lower minimum wage if you're a tipped worker, because workers that are tipped generally do better off than the minimum wage with the tip. Mm-hmm. So now he's going to have a study that basically says that we want everybody to have the same minimum wage, and but that means the tips don't necessarily have to come to the people, that the employers have to give that wage. Well, first of all, there's still other workers in a restaurant, for example, or in a car wash or whatever. A lot of these situations, they get tipped and tipped very nicely. And the irony of this whole thing is to show that you're not basing your decisions, the governor isn't on logic, but on just pure politics, is that the waitresses are going ballistic. Mm-hmm. They like it the way it is. They make substantially more dollars than if they'd make on the minimum wage. And they're afraid that if it goes up to minimum wage, there's going to be more costs to the restaurant owner, and there's going to be less tips. Or if people know that they're making more money now, they might not tip at all. So they're calling for this to not happen.
Right.
And these are the people he's supposed to be helping.
Right.
That's his position. Mine is obviously quite different.
Another part to this, he says that it will stop sexual harassment. And I just think if someone's going to be a pig, they're going to be a pig whether they're paying a tip or not.
Now think about that.
I have. Yeah.
I mean, how stupid. I can't even say there's a logic. How stupid.
It's political. Yeah,
political. Everything. Now, this is, since sexual harassment is a big issue now, mm-hmm. the issue is that if you do away with tips, a customer will not sexually harass a waitress. Well, I can't even comment further on that. It's a political hot button right now. He's trying to use every political argument he can. But logic is immaterial, yeah. As far as, and even what the waitresses want is immaterial. You know, I'd rather be on the side of the waitresses rather than impose something on them that they don't want.
Yeah, they need that flexibility. It's a different type of lifestyle, and different type of people need that.
Exactly.
Yeah. Thank you so much for your time, Senator.
Thank you.
And thank you for watching Your Voice with Senator John DeFrancisco. For additional information on what we discussed today, defrancisco.mysenate.gov.